I consider myself pretty well versed in bad movies. I love bad movies. I've probably seen more bad movies than good movies, and I'm fine with that. I've seen all the most infamous ones: Plan 9 from Outer Space, Manos, The Hands of Fate, The Room, Birdemic, Shock and Terror. I've also seen slightly more obscure ones. Love the Star Wars Holiday Special. It's not Christmas without it. One of my favorite musicals is The Apple. Desire. Meet an actual vampire. One day at a secondhand store, I found and purchased both The Island of Dr. Moreau and Winter's Tale, and I will spend the rest of my life chasing a high like that.
Find another way now!
Well, things didn't work out.
None of those are the dumbest thing I've ever seen. I'm going to tell you all about the dumbest thing I've ever seen. In 2006, TNT aired a miniseries called Nightmares and Dreamscapes. Each episode was about 45 to 50 minutes without commercials. There were 8 episodes. Each episode was based on a short story written by Stephen King. I did not see this miniseries during its original television airing. I received the DVD as a present from my mom around 2012, so I have physical copies of these turds forever. I'm never going to let them go. I think I watched each episode once and then they instantly left my head. I didn't think about them for many years until I kind of stumbled across them and it all came flooding back. Before we dive into the madness, let me just say this. I know Stephen King is a kind of polarizing author. I haven't read a ton of his stuff, but what I've read, I've liked. And here's the thing. He churns out so much material. We can all agree on that. Just the sheer volume of work he's written is impressive. Now, when you write that much and put that much into the world for consumption, statistically, not everything is going to be a winner. Some things are going to do their job and be effective and well-written and absolutely terrifying. And other things are going to be, well, that was a thing that happened. I'd also like to say, I think the nature of his material just tends to work better on the page. Psychological horror and monsters you imagine in your head, that can be very difficult to translate right on screen. I have not read any of the short stories from Nightmares and Dreamscapes. I understand that, by and large, they are better than what TNT did to them. What follows is a brief summary of each episode of Nightmares and Dreamscapes. First episode. This is an arty episode. There's no dialogue. There is still TV-appropriate language, though. William Hurt plays a master assassin who kills the CEO of a toy company, and then the toy soldiers the guy, or his mom, made come to life and spend the rest of the episode trying to avenge their creator and murder William Hurt. Yeah, you're not used to people putting up a fight, are you, William? Who's bringing the hurt now? Oh man, the tactics he employs. I do delight in his bloodlust. I hope the downstairs neighbors like the bullets. The toys succeed. He gets blown up at the end by a thermonuclear device. Every clue we're given is that William Hurt was doing the Lord's work because this toy maker was too dangerous to live. By the way, I'd like to mention, some of these episodes rely heavily on computer effects. This series has some of the worst special effects I've ever seen. Ever. It looks like they had $5 left over for the computer graphics department. They do employ practical effects in that episode, but whenever it switches over to CGI, it's instantly noticeable and terrible. Second episode. Lovecraftian horrors come to downtown London. We're filming this in Australia. The sun is beating down on us. Don't question it. The acting in this one starts out passable, and then takes a hard left turn into delicious ham territory.
No!
I won't go this way!
An American couple on their honeymoon accidentally crosses dimensions and gets lost in a mostly abandoned London neighborhood. They hear a noise on the other side of a hedge and the husband goes to investigate. That always ends well. Almost immediately we hear him screaming, he flies back through the hedge, grabs his wife's hand, and runs. You know how in the Lovecraft mythos you see an eldritch god and you go insane? Yeah, that's what happens to him. It is delightful to watch this actor pretend to be crazy.
Oh, how can we do that, Doris? How can we go back to the hotel when we are lost?
As they try to find their way back, they get separated, then he turns up again, and all of a sudden it's, who changed the channel to Tremors? The pavement cracks open behind him, and he is swallowed whole by a giant worm monster. Somehow, the best effect in the series, and that's a low bar. After this, his wife finds her way back to our dimension and is sitting in a police station tearfully telling a cop that her husband has gone missing. Oh, by the way, throughout their little adventure in the bad part of town, she keeps seeing a gray cat. Half of its face is missing. Imagine Harvey Dent as an adorable fluffy cat. Except, again, the worst CGI I've ever seen. I cannot properly explain how cheap and lazy the effects look. Anyway, in the police station, as she's trying to tell her story, a gray floof jumps past her, frightening her. It's the same cat who's been following her with half its face just poorly rendered exposed tendons. The young policeman who's taking down her story scolds the cat, calling it Lonnie. Lonnie was also the husband's name. The policeman says they found the cat that morning as a stray in the same neighborhood where the couple had their ordeal this early evening. That's the end. I was halfway expecting a title card to pop up like, the end. Or is it? Third episode. William H. Macy shines in a dual role that's less horror and more really messed up family drama. A writer of pulpy noir mysteries decides to switch places with his main character after his son tragically dies, hoping to escape from the real world and give his wife the fantasy she wants. This doesn't go as well as he'd hoped. I do enjoy the girl who shows up at the end to clean the family's pool. She witnesses the wife have a complete emotional breakdown before leaving to kill herself, and as far as she knows, the husband's completely snapped too, and has taken on the personality of his main character, and she hangs around and slots effortlessly into the role of the detective secretary at the end. It sort of implied that maybe he's becoming a writer who can manipulate reality himself, or maybe the lines of fiction are blurring in general, but I like it much better if it turns out she's just into this kind of crazy. Fourth episode. A naive but genius scientist decides there's something in the water making people mean. Bro, just lock yourself in your room and rage to eve of destruction till it sinks in that humans on a large scale have always been selfish and lazy more than anything, allowing greater acts of maliciousness to spread. He finds a small town in Texas where crime is abnormally low.
Watch this, you're not gonna believe this.
Look at my car, man.
See? He tests the water there, finds a good protein, and develops a serum from it that makes people more easygoing, less aggressive, and human beings stop killing each other. That's nice, isn't it? Maybe he should have, I don't know, done some long-term testing before dropping tons of it into a massive volcano about to erupt, contaminating the entire world's water supply. This story is told from the perspective of his older brother.
He was Lucy holding the football, promising this time for sure. And I was Charlie Brown rushing down the field to kick it.
As an older sibling myself, I also really relate to being the Charlie Brown to your younger siblings, Lucy holding the football. But after a while, you eventually do get wise to what their deal is. From the anecdotes you've told, it seems your entire childhood was watching your brother come up with a really good idea, succeeding for 2 seconds, and then spectacularly failing, often while grievously injuring himself. You should have known how this was gonna end. You did know how this was gonna end.
You don't have the slightest idea what the long-term effects might be.
Howie.
Don't even suggest that you do, Bobby, because you don't. You remember thalidomide? Yeah, nifty little pill. Caused birth defects all across the globe. Or how about the AIDS vaccine that they found? Stops the disease, but all the test subjects turn into incurable epileptics and die within the first 18 months.
Yeah, Howie, this is...
No, how do you know that this isn't the same thing? How do you know that this is not gonna come back and bite you in the ass?
I don't.
Turns out, ingesting the water causes rapid onset Alzheimer's. So, the boy wonder is basically Christopher Lee in Captain America 2, Death Too Soon. Humanity is doomed, but not in the way you'd expect. Not with a bang, but with a whimper. Fifth episode. Tom Berenger plays a horror writer from Maine, something totally different for Steven. He's driving back home from a book signing. He stops at a garage sale and buys an obviously haunted painting. He keeps getting rid of it. It keeps reappearing. Maybe him surrendering to the homicidal ghost is representative of him accepting his own mortality in the face of a possible cancer diagnosis? Maybe the haunted painting is supposed to be cancer itself?
You're a disease growing in my body.
But then, maybe not. Maybe the ending is about him losing his mind to his own fear.
I'm not your damn disease, you egomaniac. I'm what you don't know. I'm your fear.
Maybe it's about giving in to despair.
It's real.
Or maybe the haunted painting is just a haunted painting and the cancer's incidental to all this. There's no clear narrative arc or closure at the end because life is also a messily told story. I feel like they were trying to go for some kind of metaphor here, but it's too muddled to make sense of. Maybe it's symbolic of being a third-rate creation of Stephen King and somehow tripping over far more successful Stephen King novels down the stairs to your death.
Damn you.
Sixth episode. Another episode that's not horror, more family drama. There are moments when it's almost a thriller, though. Jeremy Sisto is a recently released convict whose former cellmate gets him involved in a plot to steal 4/4 of a treasure map from some other guys.
And another guy by the name of Sarge, Gulf War vet. He's a bad mother. And Jagger, he's even worse.
The even worse one meets his end by tripping over his bad mother of a victim and falling headfirst into Jeremy Sisto's gun. I can't believe someone literally tripping into their death is a plot point in more than one of these things. In the moments before that, it's actually kind of tense, but...
So why don't we just get up on our hind legs, count to 10. Last man standing takes all. One. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Like I said, almost a thriller. Seventh episode. Your standard guy is conscious during his own autopsy fair.
No signs of medical intervention.
Incompetent morons.
Rusty.
Oh, this must be hell.
We're all out of body diagrams.
Yeah.
And I'm being punished for every bad and selfish thing I've ever done. I refuse. I won't go out this way. Humiliated by a bunch of small town losers.
Hell is other people, etc., etc., etc.
What now, Commander?
Welcome to the Vietnam of Myrtle Beach!
As someone from South Carolina, I would just like to point out that Myrtle Beach is an actual city with, like, actual hospitals with competent doctors, not the boondocks. We do have cities in the South. Also, this guy is just Cajun.
Cheap shot. $5 as I can get that cane on top of the gurney. Dr. Arlen, you're stroking him back to love.
Dr. Arlen, you hottie.
That's not a semi.
That's not in the literature.
We just saw an orderly in the same situation. He was bitten by some kind of a viper they found in the elevator. Oxygen. I mean, we sure got water moccasins, rattlesnakes around here. Nobody's ever seen a snake like that before.
Sure, whatever. Who cares? And so we come to the last episode. None of the previous ones are scary, by the way. Some of them are okay or have their moments. A lot of them are pretty silly, but ultimately forgettable. None of them are the stupidest thing I've ever seen. No, that's an honor this series finale holds. This is the title of the last episode of the series. You know they got a hell of a band. I wonder how King got the idea for this thing. The only theory that makes sense to me is that he was listening to a killer playlist during the worst acid trip of his life. It's not impossible, in fact even likely. A couple is on a road trip through rural Oregon. The first 15 minutes of the episode is just padding made of red herrings. We've gotta run out the clock. They stop at a diner where they are vaguely intimidated by inline rollerblading teenage hoodlums played by men in their mid-20s. They get in the car and resume driving. The wife nods off in the car and has a nightmare about the head 22-year-old hooligan. Also, a tiny jukebox thing on a table fills with terrible CGI blood and pieces of face. She wakes up, they're lost. They come to a fork in the road, and the husband makes a random guess in which direction they ought to go.
Want my advice?
No, but I suppose I'll get it anyway. You know, I really can't stand it when you roll your eyes like that.
He seems nice. They keep driving. The wife is uneasy. She keeps telling her husband to turn around. Terror! Your nagging wife questioning your manhood and sense of direction! Surely we ought to soldier down this abandoned logging road. This can only end in good things. That... Okay. A small tree has fallen across the road up ahead. The husband gets out of the car to pull it out of the way. The wife suddenly sees him as an old man. She looks at herself in the rearview mirror and sees an old woman. Does she mention this to her husband or continue to ask him to turn around? No. Where does this go? Nowhere. Also, at one point, she sees terrible CGI animal eyes watching them from the woods. That also goes nowhere and has nothing to do with anything. Finally, they come across a sign. They're about to enter rock and roll heaven. This turns out to be a quaint, old-fashioned little town. The husband is excited by this. He wants a t-shirt. They drive into town where all of the residents openly glare at them in a hostile manner. Situation normal for these two.
It's like the town in the Twilight Zone.
Which town from the Twilight Zone? Some of them are nice. The town square has a stage and a large open grassy area, and there's a banner that says, "Concert tonight."
What are you doing?
I want a Coke.
They enter, give their order to a waitress who is trembling like a leaf and not making eye contact. Again, seems legit. There's a big jukebox in the diner filled with classic rock and roll hits. The owner of the diner comes out to greet them, and she insists they have some cherry pie.
She left a spitting image of Janis Joplin, or am I crazy? Sweating, crying out loud. It's not anything to have a panic attack over. No, this is my mother's diamonds last year. That's worth having a panic attack over.
Janis Joplin is dead.
Yes, thank you for informing us. Unless you've been in a coma since Woodstock, if you know who Janis Joplin is, you also know she's dead. The waitress brings out their pie and a napkin on which is written, "Get out while you still can."
Oh. Oh, that's incredible. Who made it?
You know, horror is all about a slow buildup of dread, but in a lot of horror movies, there also comes a moment when the protagonist makes one big fatal mistake. It's a point where they should have realized, or did realize on some level, but then failed to act on the fact that it's a trap. This can take a lot of forms. Making a wrong turn, opening a door they shouldn't, ignoring their instincts, failing to heed a warning. Even if it's not actually fatal, it does mark a point where the protagonist could have possibly gotten out of the situation much sooner and saved themselves a lot of trouble and trauma. It doesn't happen in every horror movie, but it's a moment that does turn up a lot, and it's easy to see why. It's very effective. It raises the stakes, it heightens the tension, it confirms that there is danger here, and the protagonist might not make it out alive. Her fatal mistake isn't making the wrong turn or failing to heed a warning. It happened 15 years ago off-screen when she decided to get married to and stay married to this off-putting, mean idiot.
Who made it?
Rick, take a bow.
Ozzie and Harriet, Ricky...
Nelson. Ricky Nelson.
Gotta catch me first.
That's impossible. That's impossible. He's...
dead.
We are just getting started.
Excuse me, sir.
Hey. Adam, man.
This, finally, is too much for the husband. The wife tells him that she must have left her wallet in the car. He should go and look for it. If he can't find it, she'll be out in a few minutes to help him. And he's like, okay, honey, I will head out to relative safety. Have fun in here with the specters of the dead. And he leaves.
Welcome. Well, I ain't seen you around these parts before.
My husband and I were just tourists visiting.
We are supposed to believe that the ghost of whisper-thin Buddy Holly is going to forcibly keep this woman here. Just push him the hell over!
Let me ask my husband.
As we all know, maggots have vocal cords. Barfing maggots is scary, right? Please be scared! At this point, I kind of have to give a grudging kudos to the actors they hired to impersonate these musicians. I think they all just kind of looked at each other and said, well, this is probably one of the dumbest things we'll ever put our names on. Let's just have fun. The actress playing Janis Joplin seems to have taken some heavy inspiration from Margaret Hamilton as the Wicked Witch of the West. The cackle is uncanny.
I invited him to a party and he tattooed 18 people.
The wife is frightened by the maggots, and she gets to the door, and she's out. And then Janis delivers this line.
Hey, this ain't no dine and dash, rotten crutch. Get her, boys.
You remember, Janis Joplin closed every live show with that chestnut.
In the car, Mary!
Yeah, that's the plan.
Oh my God.
Ronnie Van Zant. Dwayne Allman.
The Beatles.
It doesn't matter. They don't have any lines anyway.
Back up.
You're coming to the show.
Referring to the concert tonight. Remember that banner? He's talking about that.
You can buy a dream or two to last you all through the years, and the only price you pay is a heart for tears.
It might be too soon to assume this, but this whole thing seems almost kind of silly. Finally, husband looks over at wife, instructs her to put her seatbelt on. She does. He slams on the brakes. Ricky Nelson rolls off the car and hits the pavement. He appears to be unconscious, at the very least. All of the other musicians, who have meanwhile been hanging back, start to close in around the rear of the car. The couple puts it in park, and they just stare at unmoving Ricky Nelson for a minute, and then he gets up and smiles at them, and he's fine. Just as you'd expect. Because if a plane crash couldn't keep him dead, falling a short distance off a car going 15 miles an hour isn't going to do the job. This entire episode has a tone of, you will take this seriously! The most egregious, blatant example of this is the incidental music. I am fairly certain the guy who wrote the music was not aware of what this episode was about. Hey Jeff, can you do a couple of action-y but mostly scary music stings for us? Sure thing! The music tells us this is just as dramatic as it is terrifying, and no. No, it's not. So now that Ricky Nelson is upright, now the couple is like, okay, maybe we should resume our escape attempt. The husband floors it, rams Ricky Nelson with the front of his car. He goes down under the wheels. They run him the hell over. They drive 20 more feet and stop again to look behind them, and again he gets up and he's fine, and this time they drive and keep driving. They make it out of town and drive who knows how far down the road. Now, I neglected to mention this. Earlier in the episode, as they were entering the town, a hippie bus was driving out. You ever heard of Chekhov's gun? Meet Chekhov's party bus. This episode is taut and well-crafted. We're competent, we swear. The bus is parked the long way across the road ahead of them, blocking their way. Neither husband nor wife sees this giant, brightly colored bus until it's too late. The husband slams on the brakes, but they smash into it anyway. Commercial break! And we're back. The couple is trying to restart the car, but it's not working. And who should get off the bus but Jimi Hendrix? He is the only one whose name we are not explicitly told. But it's Jimmy. He looks vaguely like him, I guess. By that, I mean he's black. He's wearing, I don't know, the Jimi Hendrix costume available for purchase off Walmart's website. He also has an electric guitar. Okay, we get it. The show does not trust us, however, with even the smallest leaps in logic. Just to be sure we understand who this is, he starts sinisterly playing the Star Spangled Banner rendition from Woodstock.
Welcome to town, both of you. Hope you can stay a while. We're real neighborly, and we'll take care of our own. I'm the mayor around these parts. The name's Elvis Presley.
This actor, as far as I can tell, is not a full-time Elvis imitator. He has acted in things as other characters. However, on his IMDb page, I saw at least 4 credits where he plays either Elvis or an Elvis impersonator. And I mean, he is good. He's probably the most believable of these dead celebrities. So good for him.
Driving away wouldn't have done you no good anyhow. I wouldn't go nowhere but the Pumqua Swamp. No roads in there, man. There's a lot of poke salad and quicksand and other things.
Bears.
Bears. Yep. And other things.
Oh, Otis, not you too.
We stay for the show.
The show. Oh, you gotta stay for the show. We really rock. You just see it, we don't.
Ain't nothing but a stone fact.
If we stay for the show, can we go when it's over?
You know, ma'am, we're way out in the boonies out here. And attracting an audience can be kind of slow work. Although, once they hear us, everybody stays around for more. We was kind of hoping you might stick around yourselves for a while. See a few shows. And just kind of enjoy our hospitality.
Again, this guy is probably the best part about this stupid mess. He is the best impersonator and also the only one who gets anywhere close to even vaguely menacing. But they had to ruin that too. Because he's dead. Did we mention that? Also, earlier in the diner, Buddy Holly took off his glasses briefly and a drop of blood trickled from one eye. I just fear we're not getting our message across that these popular musicians with well-publicized and tragic deaths are actually dead. That would have been a better twist, though. Turns out these aren't the dead reanimations of rock musicians. This town is actually populated by insane celebrity impersonators. They have to kidnap people so they have someone to watch their lame performance. Now that would be hell. The film Mr. Lonely finally lives up to its full terrifying potential. God, I wish. That's not how this ends. They arrive back at Town Square, where folding chairs are now set up and the townspeople are gathering. The couple finds a seat next to the waitress from the diner, the one who's a normie like them and tried to help them escape.
Hi.
Up to this point, my main emotion was just wild confusion. I was also feeling indignant on behalf of these dead people, but that was kind of underlying. Here's the moment where that changed and my mind just started screaming, "How dare you?" Who could have cut off this girl's fingers?
Frankie did it.
Frankie who? Show. Don't leave us in the dark, even for a second. Don't let us guess or infer even the tiniest thing about any of this.
Frankie Lyman.
Apparently, this was in retaliation for slipping the couple that message on the napkin. Okay. Frankie Lyman was a talented black musician. He was the lead singer of a music group. Their most successful single was released when he was 14.
Frankie, you amaze me. Tell me something. You're only 13 years old, and yet you wrote this big hit. How did it ever happen?
Well, Mr. Lane, one day I was dressing, and an inspiration came to me, so I wrote the song.
Oh. Well, what was the inspiration?
I needed a new suit.
This is your first nationwide television appearance, isn't it?
That's right, sir.
And I know that everybody's waiting to hear you sing, so... are you ready to rock and roll it?
That's right.
That means I ought to get lost, huh? That's
about it.
He left the group to go solo when he was 17, and after that, his career went into decline. Developed a drug problem. He died tragically of an overdose at age 25, far too soon. And yeah, okay, he was a polygamist. However, this is a bit of a leap. You're saying that he has become an undead boogeyman who lops off the fingers of captive women for petty revenge. What the fuck? Frankie Lyman does not get an actor pretending to be him, by the way. He just gets name-dropped as the town's resident finger-taker. He does not actually appear. In a marginally better world, we would have at least gotten an ironic and Disney villain-style cover of I'm Not a Juvenile Delinquent. Do the thing that's right. You do nothing wrong. Life will be so nice.
Everyone says he was the sweetest guy you'd ever want to meet. When he was alive, he only turned mean when he came here.
Fuck you!
Crystal takes care of me. You know, she'll fix you up if you want. You don't need to lose no fingers to want to get stoned in this town.
Well, my wife and I don't use drugs.
You will.
Yeah, this is the most terrifying anti-drug PSA I've ever seen. Can we go now?
You had an auto make fun. But making fun can get you into trouble around here.
Whoa! Rock and roll heaven, are you ready?
We
got Freddie Mercury just in from London town.
Why are you doing this?
John Bonham. He'll get the lead out of your
zeppelin. I got lost. I just got lost in the woods.
Kurt Cobain.
This is what happens to people who get lost.
Stevie Ray Vaughan, the shines of music. So rock and roll heaven, are you ready to boogie? Then let's go, because rock and roll will never die.
That's what I'm afraid of.
It. Credits. What the fuck was that? I almost wish other people had actually seen this so the estates of the deceased could sue for using their likenesses. Somehow they got the rights to use Cry Baby and Pretty Woman. How? Who authorized this? There's that icebreaker question. If you could have a meal with anyone living or dead, who would it be and why? My answer is, and always will be, Stephen King. And we will sit at that table for as long as it takes him to adequately justify the existence of you know they got a hell of a band.